What's up, man?
How you doing? Thanks for taking the time to do this. Appreciate it.
Just kept on working out.
You know, since I was just talking to you about that just now, maybe we could start out with that just for if you want to.
Yeah.
I mean, what did you think of that? Because I know you talk a lot about different, you know.
Well, I don't know the backside of the story.
Yeah, I mean, Gordon Ryan's been challenging him because Galvao's like, you know, arguably one of the greatest ADCC competitors of all time. You know, people kind of go back and forward on who is. So he's been challenging, Gordon Ryan's been challenging him for probably a year or more.
Yeah.
And you know how he does, kind of like Conor McGregor type, you know, where it's mostly negative or disrespectful. So when Galvao arrived at this event, he decided to confront Gordon Ryan, and that's what you saw.
Yeah, so, but I saw him shove Ryan, right?
Yeah.
So the fight's on.
Right.
So I don't think Ryan did anything wrong.
Yeah.
And to be honest, like, I don't know their situation, but let's just say I don't know and it's neutral. Then no matter what Ryan says, Galvao, right?
Yeah.
He has no right to lay a hand on him. It doesn't matter what he says. So the second he laid his hand on, now that wouldn't be self-defense per se, but these are also two professional sport, combat sport athletes. So I don't think the rules should apply to them in certain situations. Like if the guy hits him after the bell or attacks him, you know, in a vicious way, then I think that's assault and battery. But I think, you know, like a little shove between two guys that are sport, you know, combat sport guys, and they're going at it and they might actually fight anyway. I don't know. There's a fine line there, but it's definitely not the same as somebody shoving you on the street.
Plus, I think Andre kind of put himself in a bad spot. If you're going to go and confront somebody, you have to be prepared to fight them probably at that point.
If you're willing to lay your hands on someone, shove him, then you have to be prepared to fight him. I mean, because what alpha male isn't gonna, you know, is gonna take a shove? That guy took a slap. I don't even know how he did that, but it must have been fear or something, because I mean, it looked like it started. The guy shoved him. The guy slapped him back. It should have been on, but it wasn't, because the one guy, his stomach was too big. I mean, his eyes were too big for his stomach. So when he shoved the guy, he got slapped back. I mean, he was lost then. He just kind of like, oh, well, fuck it. So that, it kind of made him look bad, you know?
And it kind of gives Gordon Ryan maybe like an edge if they do compete, don't you think?
Not jiu-jitsu, no. I mean, he mentally he might, but I don't know. I don't know their game. I mean, once sometimes, you know, that game doesn't really work for jiu-jitsu guys. But, I mean, he mentally said, I'm going to slap you in the face and there's nothing you can do about it. And guess what? He didn't do anything about it. So, I mean, it kind of showed him that it showed, you know, the other guy who was the alpha in that situation. But they might get on the mat and start grappling, and you know, one guy might be a lot more skilled than Galvao might be a lot more skilled. So who knows? Who knows what his mindset is? But he got owned there.
Yeah, you're
without a doubt.
Cool, you know, and it's kind of like, Back in the day, that probably would have had, the only way that could be settled would be to have a fight.
Well, there's not much different nowadays either. I mean, an alpha's an alpha. I mean, we got a lot less alphas now, so our society is a lot softer. But between two alphas, the rules still apply, just like they did back then. You know, an alpha's got to keep the old. That's one of the definitions of an alpha male, is it's old school. You know. So that's my interpretation.
But I mean, from the old days of NHB, you know, could a grappling match settle that?
In the old days,
yeah.
If it was two jiu-jitsu guys that wanted to do a jiu-jitsu match.
Yeah, maybe so.
Right? I mean, so, I mean, if it was like two straight-up jiu-jitsu guys that went into NHB, you know, after their, you know, jiu-jitsu, then, like, if it was Mario Spiri and Ricardo Laborio, and they didn't like each other, and one guy slapped or shoved, I think they would still grapple to see, and that wouldn't come into play, right?
Yeah, that's a good point.
So I think the grappling, you know, is their forte. Then that's where he's gonna, you know, but you know, that's where he's gonna butter his bread. But if he's gonna butter his bread with grappling, and he's not gonna fight the guy, fucking leave your hand, keep your hands to yourself. As soon as you lay your hands on someone else, you have to be prepared to get fucking bitch slapped like he did, and you better be prepared to do something back. If you're not willing to do something back, then keep your fucking hands to yourself. You know, there's no two ways about that one.
Right.
So, you know, I don't know. I mean, he bit off more than he could chew. He got a slap for a push, and then he let it go, and it made him look bad. So the only way he's going to turn that around is to beat him in a grappling match, I assume.
Yeah, and I'm sure you've seen that situation many times over your travels to different events and being involved in sport as long as you have.
Oh, you mean since 1970? Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Let's kind of talk about, you know, because I know you've talked about kind of some of your background and Chuck and things like that with people a lot of times, but I know I talked to you a little bit about what you, your involvement, your background from Hawaii.
Yeah.
You could expand a little bit more on that. Because I was talking to you about Palolo Gym and some of those things.
Yeah. It was, is someone here? Who's there? Oh, what's up, man? Yeah, you gotta go. What?
I'll get them warmed up.
Oh, get them warmed up. I'll be down. Go fluff them.
Hey.
Yeah, that's Antonio Bonwellis. He's
Yeah, I remember him. Old school.
Yeah, that was him. He's gonna go get the guys ready. We're gonna go. I'm having him do simulated fights today in the cage.
Yeah, he's been around forever.
Oh yeah, he's such a good. He was a good fighter, a great fighter. Now he's a great. He's a great coach. You know, because we coached the team together. Yeah, so like, you know, back home, it was like, it's a very rough, culture, you know? It's amazing to me their politics, because culturally they're such a tough group. Maybe the high welfare, you know, state there, it has something to do with it, but their left-leaning or, you know, liberal-leaning politics really surprised me, because it's such a rough place, and it's counterintuitive the way their politics are. But it's a rough place, you know. Hawaii's a rough place, man. You watch two youngsters fighting on the schoolyard, you know, fucking sixth grade. It's like watching two professional fighters, you know. It's like people just know how to fight instinctively now, you know, over there. It's like, I don't know why that is, but it's a natural thing, you know.
And how much did that influence you as far as what you started to teach?
Everything. It was everything. That's my roots, you know. I grew up there. I grew up on that schoolyard fighting, and I grew up knowing that if, you know, somebody looked at me a certain way, it's a fight. I knew that. I mean, that's the way it is in Hawaii, you know. You look at someone the wrong way and they're fighting, you know. It's like, and especially being, you know, my shade of whiteness, you know, they definitely dislike that until you show them you can fight, and then they respect it. But it's a very rough place, and it's old school, and it's hardcore, and you know, you have to either beta down or alpha up real quick there, you know. And so I think if I didn't grow up there the way I grew up, I'd be a lot different. I'd be I wouldn't be a fight trainer. I wouldn't have been a fighter. I wouldn't be a fight trainer, and I wouldn't have my mentality. You know, I'd be, I don't know, softer, I guess, like so many people are today.
But how did you blink? Because Was Palolo kind of where you started training, or?
No, I started with knowing that I was going to get beat up a lot in junior high school. I started at a martial arts gym, which I found in the Yellow Pages because I like the logo best. So I picked that one. You know, I got the address. I caught the bus from Kamiki. It was right across the street from Ala Moana Shopping Center on Pequoy. And it was upstairs. It was like a 500 square foot room. I mean, it wasn't much bigger than my room, right, my office right here. And there was a punching bag and a monkeywara and nothing else. So I started training there, and I knew the second I walked into that place that I was going to be doing that for the rest of my life. I was either 9 or 10, because it was 1970. So I'm going to say I was 9, 70, or 69. Anyway, I was like 9 or 10. I knew right then this was going to be my life. I was going to do that. That was going to be my home. And it was there. I was there basically until my instructor passed away in 2001. So that's where I started. And then like 4 years in, I pulled a hamstring muscle because I was more of a kicker than a puncher. And I love to kick. And I pulled a hamstring. So my instructor, Walter Godin, my martial arts instructor, sent me to a boxing gym, and he said, you know, go box for a while until your torn hamstring heals. I was like 14. Next thing you know, I'm in the Golden Gloves, and I'm boxing, and that became, you know, my mainstay for a while. But I always went back to martial arts. Then when my leg healed up, I went back to Godin. But I also started boxing, and that stayed with me until, for the rest of my career. But that's how I started boxing.
And I know you always take your guys back to Palolo. Why is that? Is that just because it's part of your roots? Or?
Yeah, it's just I take them back to a lot of my it's kind of like a pilgrimage it's kind of a celebration of where I started. So, like, I take them back to, you know, we go to Diamond Head, we go running at the beach, we go to Hala Beach and we work out there. And then we go to Mahlani Heights, Wilhelmina Rise, and we run up that hill that's like this. Then we go to Palolo Gym and we spar in the ring. Looks exactly the same as it did. So we do that. Now, that's kind of like because that's how I started. So I want my students to see how I started. And then Glover Teixeira, he started here with me, so in Arroyo Grande. So when he just tested 6 of his black belts, he brought them here and tested them here because this was his beginnings. So it was kind of the same thing but different. So that's why I bring him to Hawaii, give him a little taste of what it was like growing up there, and you know, I take him to Palolo. We go through the housing, and usually I visit a couple of my friends, and I don't know, it's just kind of a celebration of the pit.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people, I think even people on Hawaii necessarily don't know about all the housing over there and everything. You kind of brought that up. I used to, like, tutor in the housing through a college program when I was in college there. What are some of the memories of that? Because it's a pretty rough area, as you were saying.
Yeah, it's really rough, but I didn't fit in there. I mean, I think you know it going there. There was no other. I've never seen another Howley person there. Maybe there is some, but I never saw one. I remember a guy named Robert Holt, but he was a big guy. But he told everyone he was Portuguese. So I don't know. But it just felt right though. You know, it's like I know it's rough. I know. You know, but having the background of training with Walter Godin and now training, in Palolo, I just felt it didn't bother me. I would, you know, go hang out, spend the night at M. Kaivi's house, go to the Blood Bugs house, you know, Antonio, and then we had, you know, I had Lewis lived up the street, and I'd like spend the night there after training and, you know, hang out in the evening there. And I just felt because of my martial arts training, I felt at home there. If I didn't have martial arts training, I'd probably be scared as hell hanging out there. But I wasn't. I just, you know, I loved hanging out with those guys, I just fit right in. I think, you know, at least I felt I did. So it was a really rough place. So I don't even know how many fights I saw. It was like a prison yard at night. You know what I mean? Like when you hang out there at night in the housing, right in the middle of the prime, you know, it's just, and I worked at the prison for years. It was like kind of like a, it was kind of like the way they'd sit at the bench and hang out. It was kind of like a yard, you know?
Were you at OCCC or Halava?
No, I worked here at, in California State. I worked at the California State prison. I worked at CMC and I worked at WASCO.
Did you decide that was something you didn't want to do after a while?
It didn't. No, not really. It's really an easy job, and I felt it's not challenging at all. It's like, I mean, it's great for some people. You get, I mean, good pay, good benefits, but it just wasn't like, you know, I'm a registered nurse, you know, so I was like, I was used to busy places. Like I worked in LA in the ER where it was just like running all 12-hour shift at night, you know, and then you go to the prison. It's like, you know, it's just, you just sit there and just, there's a lot of sitting and talking with the other employees. And that's what you do for like seven out of the 8 hours. And so it just kind of bored me, to be honest.
So it was just better for you to just run your gym then.
I didn't think I could, you know. So I always taught in my backyard, and you know, I started training guys like Chuck and Rick and Tony the Terrible and all these fighters in my backyard. But I never thought I could do it as a living. So I always had another job. You know, I worked in the prison. I worked in the hospitals. And then one day, you know, somebody talked me into trying to just open a gym where I would train kids and stuff. I just thought that'll never work out for me because just my style, you know, it's too rough and kids won't like it and parents won't like it. And with the help of, you know, some really good consultants, martial arts business consultants, you know, like Maya and Century Martial Arts and guys like, you know, Master Bill Clark and you know, Mike Metzger. I was like, they helped me turn my, you know, rough, tough fighting stuff into a martial art where I could, without selling out, I could teach, you know, regular people and kids. So I opened the gym and boom, next thing I know, it was, it took off. And I thank God every day I did. I mean, we're packed right now. We're like packed. I mean, in the middle of all this stupidity, we are packed. And I thank God every single day that I took that turn to walk into Godin's gym in 1970. And I thank God every day that I opened that gym on Grand Avenue in Arroyo Grande in 2001. So I've made some good choices, but even more than that, I've had some, you know, great people behind me, you know, just great people. Without them, I never would be here right now. I mean, I could even, you know, like Chuck and Glover, without them, you know, they taught me every bit as much as I taught them, you know, so my students have helped me grow as a martial artist along the way. So I owe it to my instructors and my students.
As someone who came up to that California era of NHB, what was special about that place? Maybe comparing it to, because Hawaii and California were kind of similar. During the dark times when there were still shows going on in both places.
Yeah. Well, the old days, like I did the first NHB fight in Hawaii in 1976, and they had a thing called the World Series of Martial Arts. Looked way different than MMA today, but that was the first time they did in America, anything goes match, and I was 16. And I lied about my age and wrote down I was 18, and I entered. And there were some really high-level guys entering, you know, like Benny the Jet Yokides, Jeff Smith, Cecil Peoples. You know, some of the best fighters from the mainland came over there to fight in this, you know, anything goes matches. And it didn't look like anything, like I said, today, but they let you do whatever you wanted. You know, they just say, just fight. So I started doing that when I was 16, and then when I came to California and opened a gym, I just realized really quick that I wanted to teach the real thing. So just standing up you know, isn't going to cut it because there's too many people that are going to try to take you down. So I started working that into our curriculum. And then, you know, I was lucky enough to have people like Chuck and Glover and Ricardo Laborio and people like that to help me. So, you know, Sammy Henson, Matt Lindland, you know, they helped put the ground game into my Hawaiian Kempo. And without them, I would just be a, you know, I'd just be a stand-up guy. So, you know, I changed it with I have the mentality of the old school Hawaiian Kaji Kempo, and I keep the culture of that, but the techniques and the system of fighting is more like MMA for the street. So that's what I've turned my art into.
Why do you think it blew up so much in California during that time? What? Because a lot of things do there. Why do you think NHB took off there so much?
Yeah, I think because of one of the greatest martial arts ever. I'm gonna say, you know, without a doubt, Royce Gracie, or he likes to call himself Hoist Gracie. He stepped in a cage and just said, "Hey, fuck it, I'll take all comers, do anything you want, and you know, let's go." And so he exposed the weaknesses in, first of all, stand-up stuff. And then as it progressed and evolved, we started seeing the weaknesses in jiu-jitsu and wrestling when it came to a street fight. So all of these arts, we could see that none of them in and of itself were really that great. You need to combine them. No matter how good you think you are in your art, you have to be well-rounded or you're not going to succeed, whether it be a street fight or in the cage. You have to be, you know, adept at grappling, you know, wrestling and jiu-jitsu and striking and conditioning. And if you're not, you're not going to go anywhere. So he, I think, started that, Royce Gracie. And without him, I don't think we would be where we are right now. I know for a fact we wouldn't. And then came along all the other pioneers like Chuck and Maurice Smith, you know, and you know, guys like Matt Lilland and Mark Coleman and all those people built the MMA. And then from MMA, all the people watching it, all the martial arts guy, karate guys and stuff, they go, "Hey, I got to learn that takedown stuff and takedown defense. So they're going to start training that." And then the jiu-jitsu guys are like, "Man, I'm getting knocked out too much. I got to learn some more striking." Boom. And then the wrestlers were thinking, "Shit, I'm getting guillotined too much. I got to learn jiu-jitsu and striking." So you have to be, you know, you can't be a partial artist. And a partial artist is someone that only knows, you know, doesn't know the four. And the four are wrestling, jiu-jitsu, striking, and conditioning. If you don't have all four of those elements in your art, it's a partial art, not a martial art.
So you feel they were all kind of migrating to California because?
Oh, you keep going on to California. I don't think California is.
Well,
I don't think it was
a pretty influential place as far as.
I don't think so.
You don't think so?
No, I think the United States period. I think Vegas was huge. I think it started in the East Coast too. Midwest started big, you know. But I mean, I didn't see California hitting it, you know, a lot quicker. I think it was more, maybe it's a bigger state and more populated state, and it's out there more in you know, public eye. But I think they were doing this shit in this, these farm guys were loving it, you know, the fucking, those guys like Miletich guys and shit, they were like right there, you know, guys like, and then we got guys like the short, stocky jiu-jitsu guy on the East Coast, and then we got. So I think it went from coast to coast. And Brazil, you know, I mean, you know, let's not forget about Vale Tudo in Brazil, and then you know the way they fought in Japan, they had a lot of systems that were pretty much no holds barred over there too. So I you know, maybe you know some I do, but no, I don't think California was was the father or the breeding ground of MMA. I never thought of it that way, but it could have been. You know, I was in California, you know, then. So, you know, I'll take some credit for it, man. I mean, I don't think I get much credit, you know, honestly, but I'll take some. I mean, I don't mind. I mean,
yeah, I definitely think there were a lot of events going on there.
More? Well, there's more everything, though. There's more everything, right?
Right.
You know, I mean, and New York is more of a, you know, it's more of a, it's more of a, well, now they're both equal, yeah, but then it's more of a, like, you know, a lot of, you know, like a lot of plays and a lot of Broadway, and, you know, they were kind of a little more going out at night, fancy restaurants. In LA, it was kind of a little more sporty, you know what I mean? So maybe that's why.
What were your takeaways from the Chuck Tito 30 for 30, having looked at it now? And, you know, what were your takeaways from that?
I thought they did a great job. There's a couple, they did a great job. Yeah. I think they really did a great job with it. And really great bunch of guys that filmed it and edited it. And I thought it was fantastic. I think they're geniuses in what they do. In the 30-30, and a lot of them, you know, just, they're really good guys. Kind of like the HBO when they used to do the behind the scenes or whatever of the big boxing matches.
Right, right.
Remember the guy would do them? I think they were trying to play it like that. And a lot of sometimes the UFC does that, and they even try to emulate the guy's voice. But I think it's kind of like that. And I love those, man. I love watching behind the scenes stuff. And I was lucky enough to be a part of it, part of, you know, some of that stuff. So, ESPN and all the different places came out here because of Chuck and Glover and Ramsey and Court McGee and Tim Kennedy and, you know, stuff like that. So I was lucky to, like, be in the camera once in a while. Like, I'd, like, sometimes if the camera's there, I'd be like, I try to look in, like, I'm here too. Yeah, look at me. Yeah, I want to be here too. Maybe it would get me laid a little more, maybe. You know, maybe if I was, like, in front of the camera. That's the only reason my wife married me, is because she saw me on one of those shows. I think the Tap Out show. So she married me because of that.
Yeah, and, you know, looking back on how things went with Chuck and Tito, do you ever think maybe wish something was different, or no? Or do you just not really care about it?
I wish they didn't do a third fight, obviously, you know. I mean, I wasn't in favor of that at all. The third fight, you know, that would be my only regret, that they actually went through it, that I wish they didn't. But, you know what, I mean, to be honest, like, so Tito got one out of the two, you know. So, I mean, he's a great guy, you know. Chuck's a great guy. They're both great guys. They're athletes, you know. So Chuck won two out of the three, and now Tito, you know, Tito won the last one. So, I don't know, in some ways they're even. But, you know, other than that, they're both great, great, great men. They really are. They're great fathers. They're great, you know, athletes. They're great, you know, they're great people, great martial artists. So, yeah, I got nothing but great things. But obviously Chuck's like my family, so I wish he didn't do that third fight. But, you know, he's fine now, and he is, you know, he's doing great. And, you know, they're both, you know, they can both look back and be proud of that trio. You know what I mean?
The third fight, did he like talk to you about doing it, and you just told him you didn't want him to, and he just decided to go ahead, or?
In a roundabout way. We weren't really, we didn't agree with it. So we just decided to, you know, separate right there for that fight. So, you know, we've talked about it after, but I didn't really want much to do with the whole thing. I would have liked to gone, because I wanted to, if I had to protect him, or, you know, try to tell him, you know, like, maybe give him some advice going in that I saw, I might have saw something, or make sure he doesn't get hurt, you know. So if I had to stop it or something, I always want to do that. But the referee stopped it in a great way. And he didn't get hurt, you know, I mean, really. And so it worked out fine. We're fine, and he's fine with Tito, and Tito's fine, and at the end of the day, it's fine. I said fine like 10 times just now.
Now, I know you're about to get back to training here. Maybe, you know, I appreciate you taking time to do this. Maybe something you want to, people that are watching this, something you could leave behind or something you want to talk to people about.
Don't ever let anyone take your lunch money. That's what this country is going crazy right now, and there's too many people like that guy, that Brazilian guy. I mean, he shoved the guy. So like, there's so many people out there right now who are fucking shoving. They're shoving, and then once they start getting bitch slapped back, you know, shit's gonna hit the fan really bad. It's gonna end badly for them. So, like, a lot of people have taken a lot of shit already, and we've put up with a lot of shit and got pushed a lot. And pretty soon we're going to start bitch-slapping back. And I just mean, you know, as a country, you know, we're just there's too much behind the keyboard fucking being brave or out there in front of everyone where they know nobody's going to attack them back because there's too many cops around, so they run their fucking mouth or they – put their hands on people, or they burn down a business, or they throw rocks through a fucking somebody else's business they've worked their entire life for. You know, it's just it's getting crazy. And for you guys, I say, don't let anyone take your lunch money. Don't let anyone take your lunch money. If you do, I mean, you get what you ask for. You know, so it's time to stop. Stop taking, you know, letting people take our lunch money. That's all, you know. I mean that in a figurative and literal way.
Because I know you put videos out there, but how many people do you think you can reach with those? Or have you ever thought about, like, running for office or something like that? Or
No, just...
Yeah.
I mean, people, yeah, I mean, no, but I want my word out there. I want it to be out there just because... If it wasn't for people like Godin and, you know, some of the people coming up when I was coming up, giving me the word and giving me the shove. I had a buddy named Adam Kaivi. If any of you guys out there in Hawaii, he's you know, he just moved from the housing to Waimanalo. I think he's got some Hawaiian homestead land now. He's a bus driver, and he was one of my best friends growing up. And he was the big tough guy from the housing, and he gave me words of, you know, encouragement. He was there, had my back all the time. And, you know, somebody wants to pick on the Howley, you know, he would say, go get him, bro. I got your back. And I would, you know, that way nobody else would jump in. So guys like that always had my back. Walter Godin always had my back. You know, Kari Karu, who was my special motivation counselor in high school, always had my back. Without those people, you know, I would be fucking sitting in the corner right now crying, wearing a dress, you know. So it's because of those people that, you know, they helped me come up and become an alpha male. So I want to help people. That's all.
Because I know you do a lot of things where you're answering questions from people and things like that on here. So
I want everybody to get it. You know. Now, it doesn't have to be exactly my way, but I mean, there's just no upside. There's no upside to being a beta male. I mean, the only good thing about a beta male is if you go to prison or jail, you want a beta male to be your cellmate, right? Because someone has to give you a full body massage and paint your toenails and shit and do other things that your wife would usually do for you when you're home, right? And that's the only thing that a beta male is good for. And so we, as alpha males, we have to realize that and stand our ground.
Yeah, that's a good message. I mean, I agree with you. I think a lot of things are maybe not going the way they should, you know. I don't know how much we can do about it, but, you know, it's one of those things where you can kind of reach one person or maybe two or three. That's even good to do.
If you can reach one person, it's better than no one. You know, and the world's turning like this. So if we just don't do anything about it, we're just going to be, you know, we're just going to be, you know, sheep, right? I mean, we'll just be sheep. So it's either be a fucking man, an alpha male, or be a beta sheep.
Right.
That's it. Right.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate you taking the time to do this. I know you guys got to get back to training.
I got the team in the cage right now. We're going to do some training. So nobody takes your lunch money. And when nobody takes your lunch money, it's different because for them, yeah, I want them to stay safe in the street, but they're fighters. They're fighters. They're sport fighters. I want them to become UFC champions. And that's nobody taking their lunch money. Like when Glover, nobody takes his lunch money, that means in the cage, right? With my other students, like my cops and my, you know, my other regular students, that means somebody tries to jump them on the street. I want them to protect themselves. If you can't protect yourself in the street, then you're a beta male and you might as well let your wife take care of you or something. And let me just tell you something. If you can't take care of yourself and you can't take care of your family and you get the shit kicked out of you in front of your wife, things will never be the same in the bedroom between you and her. She's never going to look at you the same. She's never going to cook for you the same. Things will never be the same again if you do not have to protect her if she gets jumped in the street. Bing. Right?
Or your student, or your students, right?
Yeah. Yeah, but it's on them. They gotta do what I say. And so if they don't, or they,
what we were talking about at the beginning, the guy's got to go back to his school after he just got smacked. You know.
Yeah, he probably won't come back though. If somebody gets their ass whooped, they're not gonna come back. But they do have to go back home, and
no,
that's gonna be a.
It's his team.
Oh, you do you mean? Oh, okay, that guy. I really don't know the backstory. I don't know him, but from what it looked like on that video, he's gonna get a lot of fucking. They're gonna brutalize him.
Yeah, and going back to his gym, that's gonna be awkward.
Yeah, that's what I mean. They're gonna brutalize him. His other teammates, they're gonna be like, "What the hell? You made us look bad, bro. Somebody slaps you like if somebody slaps you like that, you have to." You have to do something. You just have to. I mean, because if you don't, I mean, then you don't. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's good.
So, hey. Yeah. All right, brother. Hey, thanks for that. That was great, man. I'll see you guys. Everybody out there, don't let anyone take your lunch money. You got to start training. If you're not training and somebody jumps you, you're going to be sorry. It's going to be too late. It's like jumping out of the airplane and go, oh, shit, I forgot my parachute. It's too late. You got to start training before you get jumped, not after. All right. See you guys. Thanks, brother.
It's great talking to you, sir.
Good talking to you. Bye.
Bye.